Lord, give me strength every day. He does what he's doing. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Glad to see y'all this morning. And all that. Pastor Ian, late, they got called out to Oakland to minister over at Love Center Ministries, the Hawkins family, this morning. So I sent some books down there. But, I said, it's the cost of leaving me on my release day after straight after making such a big deal. You know, all of my about it, and after that, well, I'm gonna say it. Deuces. I'm like, I can't tell you what I said, but that's not how I take a case with it. That's the cost. I said, you can sell every one of them. Amen. But no, you know, that's what's happening. You know, there's calls to say, hey, come minister here and there. And so pray for them while they're in Oakland. Amen. The Warriors. Amen. And all that. Listen. Leaders, I'm not gonna hold you. You're not gonna hold you long because I know that's been, you know, that game. You know, I'm like, oh man, I still wanna have it. But listen, this is the last one though for the summer. So leaders, you come on out for this lead meeting. We're going to work things out, and we just wanna encourage you and give you some plans what we're gonna do this summer. Please come on out. Everybody, come on. Every ministry leader, worker, come on out. Amen.
All right.
So you can know what's going on. What's going on? What's happening? Today? During our summer. During our summer. Bro, it's out, y'all. And I'm so glad to have it out here and everything. The beauty releases and all that. Oh, there you go. Clap it over. Amen. So excited about please grab a copy for your friend. Amen. Amen. Let's see what's in here. What's
Mama.
Oh.
Mama.
That's a good story.
Oh.
That's a good story, right? Right there. Oh. So. How many of you been to a balloon factory? Have you ever been to a balloon factory? No? Oh my God. So you've never been to a balloon factory. I think most of you were. But let me tell you about balloon factories. It's in the book. About balloon factories. They're quiet, steady. You know, they're steady work because birthdays, holidays. It gets a little crazy though around New Year's. New Year's. Because, you know, it's New Year's, right? Balloons everywhere. And all that. But the workers there, they're kind of timid, a little scary even, because they don't like sharp objects, pins, needles. And they don't like, you know, anything to disturb the balloons. Now, the balloon factory is a great place. I mean, for those of you know, like steady work. Like everything, you know, it's great for those types of people like the status quo. It's predictable, it's secure, and everything. But and for the most part, you know, it's cool. I mean, who wouldn't want to work in a balloon factory? It's colorful, right? You know that helium thing? That's kind of cool. Sometimes they, you know, they go wild in the helium, and their voices go up. It's steady, it's predictable, it's secure. One thing that the balloon factory workers don't like are unicorns. Unicorns. Who knows what a unicorn is? They're like, oh my God, you've been lost on a Sunday morning. You know how hard it is? the pointy thing. Balloon factory workers hate unicorns come to the balloon factory. You know why? Because I got a hard thing. Come on now. on their and point. And so the first thing they do is like, shoo, shoo, unicorn, go away, unicorn, go away, go away. Why? Why? Because they don't want them to disturb the predictable, safe environment that's in the balloon factory. Balloon factory. There's no unicorns, they got rambunctious. They don't listen to nobody. And they go up in that balloon factory and they start coming in and bumping into stuff. And next thing you hear, pop, pop, pop. Somebody say pop. Pop, yeah, they say pop. And what happens? They start popping the balloons. And that's when everything goes crazy in the balloon factory. Because the unicorns are let loose. And they have disturbed, disrupted the predictable, secure, steady environment of the balloon factory. Today I want to challenge you to move from being a balloon factory worker and to be a unicorn. Somebody say pop. I want you to go into your job and disrupt some stuff. I want you to go into your school and get on somebody's nerves and disrupt some things. I want you to go into your environment, wherever it is, where your balloon factory is. I want you to go on there and pop some balloons. Turn to people and say, be a unicorn, be a unicorn, be a unicorn, be a unicorn, be a unicorn. Be a unicorn. Pop some balloons. Pop some balloons. You say, what's this got to do with Sunday morning church and Jesus? Well, you know, to be a unicorn, it takes all faith. Faith. In order to pop a balloon, you go ahead and go against the status quo, to be a disruptor, to be a change maker, a change agent, to be innovative, you're going to have to use faith. See, God has called you more to just sitting here and listening to me and having a great time on the earth. He's called you to disrupt a few things. He's called you to change a few things. And the only way you're going to change a few things is if you get bold enough to walk into your balloon factory and say, I'm about to pop some balloons in this place. All right, I call this innovation. Being innovative. I define innovation as causing change that sustains. Change. Because the world's changing. How many know the world's changing? In fact, it's changing so much you can't keep up with it. I mean, like Mother said, the gas price is up one day, down the other, up on Tuesday, then down on Wednesday. It's just craziness. You know, change. You know, boys and the girls go for the boys. Change. But then, change. So change is not the answer, but innovation. Is because innovation is change that sustains. That means I'm going to make a mark in my balloon factory, in my world so much, I'm going to change the whole environment. It's going to stick. It's going to stick. 10 years ago, there was no such thing as an iPad. Everybody. I think about 12 years ago, there was no such thing as a smartphone. Right. But Steve Jobs and him, they said, we're going to be unicorns in this balloon factory, and that changed the whole industry. Remember 8-track tapes? Y'all remember that? 8-tracks, can't find them no more. But the vinyl, I know it's making a comeback, but you can't find them probably no more unless you go to a specialty store. You make CDs? are kind of going, now you can download everything. Why? Because of somebody was a unicorn being innovative and caused change that sustains. Turn to this neighbor, it's time to be an innovator that caused change that sustains. But in order for you to do that, it takes faith. Or for my Bible scholars, Romans 12 and 3 says, God has given to every person, every man and woman, a measure of faith. A measure of faith. Did you not know that it's suicidal to try to create change without faith? It's suicidal to try to create change without faith. Why? Because faith, the substance of things, for Hebrews 11 and 1, the things of not seen. If you don't have faith for it, then it can't, it won't, it just won't happen. So you've got to have faith to be a unicorn. So you can pop some balloons. Why is faith so necessary? Oh my God, I got this breakthrough. Oh, from this wonderful book, Faith to Innovate. It says, faith is the passport to a better state of being. Why? Why? Because if you can faith for it, if you can think it, if you can believe it, God drops it in your spirit, then guess what? That means it's yours for the taking. Amen. So let me make sure you understand this. So that means no matter, Sister Mona, it didn't matter that you weren't necessarily qualified for the promotion. But God dropped that job, that position in your spirit, faith start to work. And faith says, here's your passport. What the passport is? It allows you to cross realms, cross countries, to give you access to other lands. You did not risk, come on, I need you to help me out. Other domains. And so faith is my passport to get to where I'm thinking of, what I'm believing for. And so it doesn't matter that I don't have the degree. It don't matter if I don't have the money. It don't matter if I don't have the education. It don't matter. As long as I got faith. Oh, you better come on. I can get to my better state of being. So turn to the next neighbor. Faith qualifies you. Faith qualifies you for the things that you can't see. But faith qualifies you for things that people say that you can't do. Faith qualifies you. Somebody shout, I got faith. I need somebody to understand that you have great faith, and it qualifies you for things that you dream of. Faith qualifies me. Oh, good God. It's a passport to a better state of being. It's an inner attitude, it's a conviction, it's a trust. And since we got God, we know that it's approved. We got backup. So that's not just faith merely in ourselves, but it's faith. Oh my God, who got faith in God? Faith, look like God will work it out. Look like God will make a way. Somebody in here has the testimony that when you couldn't work it out, when these things are not going to work out, faith stepped in, God stepped in and said, here's a way out of no way. Here's a door where there was no door. Here's an opportunity. I need somebody here that understands the power of faith and how faith will allow you to be a unicorn. Create change in the world and get you to a better state of being. Why you need faith? A couple of things. One, because if you imagine, people who work in factories don't like people. had adversity in your life? Try to stop you, stop your dreams. Anybody here that know that God told you what He told you, and then you turn around, and you're excited about it and everything, but you turn around, you're pursuing what God told you, and you run up to adversity. Anybody here? Come on, y'all talk back to me. You run up to adversity. Tell people, first of all, it's people. It's crazy how people, how much people love to tell you what you can't do. Everybody hear what I'm talking about? They love to tell you how unqualified you are. They love to tell you what you can't do, how uneducated you are, how it's out of your reach, and how you shouldn't do that. And then when, because of you striving, they start hating on you. And anybody here got some haters? Because of your faith. Anybody here got some people that's criticizing you? Look, handling adversity coming at you because of your faith. See, you need faith to overcome the haters. Because here it is, unicorn, faith. The haters are coming. The haters are here. The balloon factory workers don't want you popping balloons. The folks at the school don't want you getting A's. The folks at the job don't want you taking their promotions. Even family. Oh my God. I don't look at nobody, but there's some family members that don't want to see you succeed, don't want to see you be promoted, don't want to see you get to the next level. Why? Simply because they're not there.
To move, even when you're afraid.
See, people don't, this is what people don't say about courage. Courage, having courage does not mean not being afraid. What courage actually means is being able to move forward in spite of being afraid. I know the word says, don't be afraid, don't be afraid, don't be afraid. I asked him, I had conversations with him. I said, why do you tell him, don't be afraid, and you keep on saying stuff that scares me? Anybody had that question? I'm scared out my mind. He said, don't be afraid, don't be afraid. I'm like, what are you saying? I'm scared. Don't be afraid, don't be afraid. What do you say? I'm scared. Don't be afraid, don't be afraid. What he's actually saying is, have courage, Joshua.
Yeah.
Have courage, because I'm with you. Have courage. Use your faith. Have courage. I know you're afraid, but have courage, because if I promise it to you, I'm going to give it to you. Have courage. Move while you're afraid. Do it, even though you're afraid. Work it, even though you're scared. For a long time, I had to be used to stand up and talk and all that. And so, maybe I didn't say it, but my mouth get dry. You know, it got paste in your mouth. Like I can't explain nothing. Sound drunk. But then I just kept on talking. Even though I was afraid. And the pace went away. And I started getting used to it. My knees stopped shaking. Because I just kept on doing it. And here's the key. If the more you do it, the less afraid you will be. And what they call that? They call that courage. Courage, courage. Could it be? If I go swimming? Swim. Oh yeah, I know the wrong crowd. Black folk don't swim. We swim. Swimming. Huh? I gotta go swim. The hardest part of going swimming is getting in the pool, right? Yeah. In the pool because why? No, because it's cold. It's cold. So what do you do?
No.
If you get in the pool, what do you do? You jump. That's right. You jump on in. What I'm trying to tell you is, it's time for you to get in the pool. And if you don't get in the pool, you better what? Jump on in. President, it's the name of jump on in. It takes courage to jump in. But once you're in there, it feels like feeling good to you. Get that once you get over the initial shock of it all, then you're like, you're used to the water. So I'm used to this. I'm used to this. And last one, there's a community place, like the Pinnell Center down the street where I was growing up. They had multiple pools.
Right.
So we started at the kiddie pool.
Right.
I was like, oh, yeah, this is good. And then I looked across the way and I said, there goes the big pool right there. There goes that big pool. And guess what? My curve was built up over here in the kiddie pool. The shallow waters. But then I said, I said, let me go into this big pool. And here I go. That's everything I know. What used to scare me at the shallow pool, at the kiddie pool, don't scare me in the mid pool. And instead of me hesitating, I just want to jump on in. I'm trying to tell you something right now. That guess what? There's a bigger blessing for you. And it's just waiting for you to just want to jump on in. When you jump, balloons pop. You start to make change. In the world. I wrote this book because I was like, I was scared. Just lost my parents, and we was on the verge of losing it.
I was like, my God? My mama dead, dad dead. Now I'm about to do things. I said, Lord, I'm upset. I was scared. And I was ready to go this way.
You know what's not right? What am I doing? What am I doing? I paused my mind. That's it. Okay. Hold on.
I was ready to call quits. I said, Lord have mercy. I said, don't be afraid. I'm scared out of my mind. I ain't never done this before. All these people trying to believe in me and hold me accountable. Folks telling me what I can't do, what your church ain't, you know, what you don't have, and all that. And for a minute, I started to believe them. I said, Lord, you're going to have to help me on this because this balloon is too big for me to pop. Right. my horn is not as sharp and everything. And I said, all right. And they say, start saying, you know, if you didn't have your daddy's name on that building, you'll be fighting so hard. You can't do it. You can't afford it. And I was like, well, maybe you're right. Maybe you're right. And then, so I said, a seed. I remember something my mom and my dad talking. I saw them do it. They said, keep on educating yourself. Keep on learning. He said, because leaders are learners. And you need to find out what you don't know. So I enrolled myself in school.
That's right.
Leadership school. I found out there's a whole bunch. But I didn't know. I didn't know there was other ways to lead people. I didn't know that leadership was a relationship between the leader and the follower. And that it's not just up to me to make it happen, but it's up to we to make it happen. It's a partnership. It's a relationship. That means that I can't depend on you as much as you depend on me. And we have to work this thing out together if we're going to pop some balloons. If you've been trying to go at it alone, and guess what? You're doing the wrong way. You need to find some people to help you out. I tell my class every time, I say, if you call yourself a leader and you're walking alone, there's nobody following you, you're just taking a walk. You're not a leader, you're just taking a walk. Leaders got followers. Leaders got people walking behind them, people beside them, and everything said, let's go. Serving others, the people's needs, serving leadership. I teach it now, like I've been doing it all my life. And everything, but I've been doing it all my life because I was a business guy. I saw my dad do it. I didn't understand. I'm a business guy. I'm a Donald Trump guy. I'm the boy in the boardroom saying, you're fired. You ain't do as I say. You know, you're getting time. If you don't do that shit, you ain't gonna get time. They're ready for midday if I work. But then I found out people are grown. And that only works for some time, Mother Rose. And it's running in church, we can't pay nobody. My God. And so you need to start, you know, you need to work it out. Come in a little timid, no better, and be respectful. And be a servant and say, how can we make this a win-win? How can we elevate each other and be in relationship? Because it's not just about me, it's about me. It's about us. It's about us all being unicorns. Using our measures of faith with courage. I think I'll tell you, believe that is. We have to look at that faith, allow me to pursue and keep going and move forward. You are not the end of the story. We won. We won. Not me. We. But in order for us to move from survival to thriving, this is where I believe God calls us. He wants you to know your why. And in that process, 4-year process, I discovered my why. My why is to use and maximize every gift that God has given me to build up God's people, to be leaders, to change the world. That's my why. If it does not fall, if an opportunity comes, it does not fall to my why, does not match up to my why, I'm not doing it.
Amen.
Woo! I ain't doing it. But if it matches up to my why, I'm all in it. Because I don't got time to waste time. You don't got time to waste time either. Do you know your why? Your purpose? You can write that thing out. In business world, they call it mission statements. Right? And if an opportunity comes that don't align with their mission statement, then they're not doing it. They're not buying it, they're not working it out. Everything has to align with the mission statement. Your why is your personal mission statement. And let me tell you, God designed you just to hang out down here. He designed you with purpose. And that means you have a why. A why. And guess what? That why causes change. That why makes you unicorn instead of the balloon factory worker. The why is the one that allows you to pop balloons, make change that sustains, and be innovative. Do you know your why? You know your why. How many of you are under the age of 35? 35 and under. I couldn't hear. Why? Come on, raise your hand. Could you just stand up real quick? 35. Between 1980 and 2000, you were born those years. 1980 and 2000. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1980 and 2000. 1980. Come on, stand up. 1980 and 2000. Well, they probably younger than that. I'm looking at my millennials right now. Stand up real quick. Stand up. Stand up. Everybody under 35. Everybody under 35. 35 and under. Now, I want you to look, because I know there's a whole crowd. I'm not going to get too much. But let me tell you, you are now. Yes, right. We just celebrated 22 years of marriage. Some of y'all are not even 22 years old. I looked at my wife, I said, you're getting old. We're getting old. That's the realization. So that means this next move now, Rose. This next move now, baby boomers and veterans, Gen Xers, this next move for everybody that's 40 and above, we gotta start training and empowering these. Because you are our next leaders. You are the ones that are about to take up the mantle and run with it. This is all me heart right here. I'm dedicating myself to you all.
Amen.
So that legacy continues.
Amen.
Because you are our now or our future. Huh? You're going about to take this thing. I ain't trying to go nowhere. But while I'm here, we're going to work it out together. So I need you to succeed. We need you to succeed. We need you to be unicorns. Hashtag be a unicorn. Be a unicorn. Pop some balloons. Make change. Make change. And let me tell you this. I know things seem unstable right now. But I'm here to tell you and prophesy on you. You keep on running. Have faith and courage and know your why. And things will stabilize. And God's going to bless you. He's going to bless you, Joshua. He's going to bless you to be a blessing to the nations. I need every baby boomer, Gen Xer, and Reverend to find a millennial and under and start blessing them right now. Come on, just turn around and start blessing them right now. Bless them right now, just give me the blessing. Come on, pray for them, touch them. Come on. Find them, there's one behind you. Go behind you, move. All up. Come on. Veterans, baby boomers. This is what we need to do. Come on, lay hands on them. And say, I need you to survive. I need you to be wonderful. I need you. I need you. Don't be a balloon factory worker. Seniors, if you can, just reach over to them. Lay over a blessing on them. Because they're about to move, they're about to work it out. This future, they hold our future. And we need to be unicorns.
I'm able to be
go past the fifth grade level in math and writing. My mama said, you are tripping. The devil is a lie. She took me and tutored me over the summer. Next thing I know, I'm in a private school in sixth grade, in a private school, in a magnet program. Huh? Everything they labeled as a, they didn't have to turn gifted. The teacher didn't know how to teach me. Because in many ways, I was smarter than the teacher. Parents, don't let people tell you your kids are stupid and they can't do stuff. You gotta be bold, a bold unicorn, and tell them I'm going to pop your balloon because I believe in my child. Time. Come on, put your hands together.